famine early warning system started in 1985, and it was started as a consequence of the massive loss of life, over a million people, due to drought-related famine in the Sahel and Ethiopia and other areas of East Africa. The idea was to make sure that nothing like that would ever happen again.
The Famine Early Warning System Network, also known as FUSENET, helps the U.S. Agency for International Development plan its food aid and relief efforts. It combines satellite and on-the-ground data to predict droughts months in advance.
There was not a lot of work that really looked in a kind of rigorous way at how to combine those two sources of information in the best way. And so that's been, you know, one of the things that I've specialized in.
There have been a number of initiatives which allow for the an increase in the number of rain gauges that are available. The satellite data really hinges on the rain gauge data for its calibration.
We now have a product called the Climate Hazards Group Infrared Precipitation with Stations, or CHIRPS, which combines observations from satellites and gauges to produce what's probably the best rainfall product for drought early warning.
CHIRPS was deployed in early 2015, just in time to monitor worsening conditions of drought in Ethiopia.
CHIRPS data set was in many ways kind of designed from the get-go to deal with rainfall in Ethiopia, because it's a really challenging place to try to track rainfall variations. It's incredibly mountainous, and those mountains have a huge impact on the rainfall, where you can go from really wet highlands to super hot, dry lowlands in, you know, maybe 50 kilometers.
Over the years, FUSENET has improved its ability to predict climate patterns, like the El Niño Southern Oscillation, where sea surface temperatures shift every few years in the equatorial Pacific Ocean. The shifts lead to weather changes all over the world, even as far away as Africa.
It was forecast to be one of the strongest El Niños on record. In Southern Africa, the El Niño Southern Oscillation tends to have that correlation between El Niño and below normal rainfall.
The drought in Ethiopia in 2015 was very similar to the drought in 1984, you know, that helped kill a million people.
The outcome of the 2015 drought was very different than 1984. Early warnings led to increased food aid, helping the nation avoid many deaths. But human-induced global warming will worsen droughts and storms, which means that the specter of drought and famine isn't going away.
You have in mind that in the background, the odds have been tilted in one direction or another because of climate change, then that helps increase confidence in the outlooks that are produced.
We should be expecting, you know, more of these extreme events, these really strong El Niño and La Niña events.
In the last 5 years, at least, we've had those sequence of droughts, which have had increasingly negative impact on households simply because of the reduction in the coping capacity.
If this happens again, and we're in this situation where we're grappling with a kind of post-COVID reality, I'm worried about in the future, if we have a reduced economic capacity, that a kind of El Niño like that happens again could have really dire consequences. Our scope now is to always be able to work globally and be able to respond wherever we're going to be needed in the future.